Thanks for making the time. Really appreciate it. Jimmy Pedro is a retired American judo competitor who won multiple world championships and multiple bronze medals in the Olympics and world championships. And the CEO of and president of Fuji Mats. I get my mats from you. And vice president of Fuji Sports, right?
Yep.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for your business. And thanks for having me on.
Thank you. So I had Ronda Rousey, and you know, I'm friends with a lot of Armenian judokas, you know, in the area, like Gokar and a lot of his disciples, you know.
Caro and Manny.
Yeah, you know. And so, you know, they're all bummed out with the situation in judo and just because of the rules and things like that. But before I get into that, I guess I wanted to ask you, like, how did you get started in judo?
I was born right into the sport. My dad was a judo coach. He was a sensei. So ever since I can remember, you know, even as young as being in diapers, just being at the dojo, running around the mats, watching kids train, wrestling with whoever didn't have a partner. You know, they'd grab me and they'd wrestle with me and do stuff. And then when I was 5 years old, that's when my dad said, okay, it's time you officially start training. And you know, I did a couple days.
5 years old.
An hour. 5 years old. Yeah. And that's all I've known ever since, you know. I've been a part of either my father's dojo or then later on started my own dojo. When he closed his down, I opened up one myself, and we just kept the family legacy going.
But your dad was a high level competitor as well.
So my dad started judo a bit later in life. He started when he was 19 years old. So, you know, for him, it was a lot of hard work, right? He didn't have that innate movement. Judo is a lot of, as you know, it's a lot of feel. It's a lot of, you know, understanding the ebb and flow of the game. And he never got that feel for the sport. He was more of a physical, hard-nosed, like, fighter, you know, and he just grinded. So for him, it was, you know, even though he got a late start, he ended up making it to, you know, national medal winner a couple of times. He made it to the Olympic trials. He took second in the Olympic trials in 1976. He represented the United States at the Pan Ams. He won a bronze medal at the Pan Am championships and stuff like that. So, he did well with his career, but he never made the Olympics. He never made the world team. He wasn't the best of the best in the States. And at the time, judo in the United States was pretty competitive. You know, it was one of the bigger martial arts in the States in the 70s. So, obviously much deeper field than it is now in America. But, you know, he did what he could with the sport. So he wasn't necessarily a high-level competitor in terms of world and Olympic status, sure. But he was, you know, very well-respected in the United States. You know, like I said, competed in the Olympic trials. But more importantly, he became a mastermind of the game, really understood judo, understood how to coach and how to train athletes. And because he started later in life, he had to sort of be smarter than everybody else, right? He read numerous books and studied coaching philosophies and training methods and things like that. And I can remember me as a kid, as early as like late 1970s, early 1980s, you know, my dojo, we were doing plyometrics. We were doing medicine ball throws. We were doing, you know, all these like functional strength training exercises that everybody's doing now. We were doing that 30 years ago because my dad was a coach, saw that when he was in Russia or when he was overseas training, and brought it back home and had all of us doing that stuff from a very young age.
What kind of books, mental books, did he?
I'm not sure he read any of mental training philosophies, but it was more the physical conditioning. You know, he read like all, I don't know a specific book, but I just remember my father having oodles and oodles of books that, you know, whether it was diet and nutrition or strength training and conditioning for sport or peaking for performance and things like that. And so, you know, that was just passed down to me through doing it. You know, my dad and his training methods and how we trained and how we prepared for the biggest events. I think that's really his specialty, is peaking athletes for, you know, the right moment. And if you look at the history of our judo academy, you know, I always had great performances at the world championships or the Olympic Games, as have all of my students. You know, when they've always risen to the occasion and performed at the highest level. And that's, you know, started with me, then it went with, you know, Ronda, Then it went with, you know, South Sheet Ronda took a second in the World Championships, took a third in the Olympic Games. And then after that, it was followed up with, you know, Kayla taking a gold medal in she's junior world champion.
Amazing.
Then gold medal in the senior worlds and gold at the Olympics, you know, and then Travis taking a silver at the World Championships and then a silver at the Olympics. So it was always, our athletes always performed when the chips were down and all the stakes were there. And that really comes through the training and the peaking for performance.
Interesting. Your dad specialized in that. He started later in life, so he had to work harder, you felt like, to catch up and to get ahead and give you guys the...
And he's always one of those, you know, he's a coach that thinks all the time. And I think it's important for every coach to understand you have to continue to try to learn new things and you have to observe. When you're training, you observe everything. You watch what people are doing, how they're doing it, you know, watch the moves, try to ask questions on how to do that move, you know, if you see something different, and then bring it back to the dojo and have the guys in your team start working on new stuff. So even if it doesn't become their specialty, at least they're exposed to it. They've seen it before, then how to defend it, or, you know, perhaps somebody picks it up at the school and it becomes their main technique.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's something my father always did. He always brought back something. Hey, I saw this Korean guy doing this and I think we should start working on it. Or I was, you know, watching the guy from Russia and how he defended this thing. And I think we should start teaching that. So he's always thinking, learning, evolving. Always.
You mentioned Russia a few times now. Were the Russians, like, you know, is that where he learned the most of his, like, strength conditioning?
Eastern Europe at the time, you know, Europe. East Germans and the Russians. And, you know, back then it was the Soviet Union. You know, so it was just one Russia, right? Regardless of where you went. Now there's, you know, whatever it is, 15, 25 different countries of Russia that are all broken up. And now we got to beat 15 or 25 of them, not just one. So it makes it a little bit harder today, but. Yeah, he picked a lot of methodology up from there.
Yeah, I've done, like, you know, strong first, and, you know, I done it's all like Pavel's you know, work, and he talks about, you know, like in America, right? Like if you're a trainer, your logs belong to you, but in the Soviet Union, if you're a trainer, the logs belong to the government, and
right.
So the largest case study, right, in the history of mankind. And so the Russians, they, you know, like, this works, just do it, you know, because they knew it worked.
Right.
And so a lot of the strength, like a lot of those strength things, right, they still stand today. Like and I guess it just goes across the board, right, with sports and things like that, as far
Absolutely.
As the right conditioning for peak performance.
Yeah.
It's amazing that your dad was able to. And then, Jimmy, you were the first Olympic medalist?
No. So I was the first Olympic medalist from my academy, or from, you know, my dad's student. You know, we had a lot of talented young kids that were junior national champions or went on to win the senior national championships in America that were my dad's students. But I was the first student that actually made the Olympic Games from our academy.
Okay.
And that was a big deal. That was 1992. The United States had many Olympic medals before me. I think it was like 6 or 7 medals before my medal in 96. So, but we've won between myself, Rhonda, Kayla, Travis. I mean, we've won like a lot. And the only exception was Marty Malloy. She was from California, San Jose, California. She won in 2012, she won a bronze medal. But every other Olympic medal has been produced, you know, either a student in my academy or someone who came through and trained for extensive periods of time.
So Rhonda's, you spent a lot of time, I assume, with Rhonda's mother?
Yes, Anne-Marie.
Anne-Marie, yeah. And how was the judo scene back in the 80s, I guess, right? 70s and 80s compared to, I mean, now it's gone down a lot, right? Because of, you know.
Yeah, the numbers have dwindled a lot, right? So the number of people doing judo today is significantly less than it was back in the 70s and 80s. So the fields were deeper, the sport was much more organized, or a lot more big clubs and really good coaches. A lot of them came from Japan and opened up academies, and then their students had really good technique and they were big schools. And back then, you know, karate wasn't what it is today. Taekwondo wasn't what it is today.
Right.
Jiu-jitsu didn't really exist back then
right.
in America. You know, so it was the martial art. And if you look back at in the 70s and 80s, you watch a lot of the television, you heard the word judo or judo chop or judo throw.
Right.
There was a lot of references to that. You saw a lot of Tomoe Nagis and was incorporated in the movies, and you had Gene LaBelle, who was, you know, a big name in Hollywood back then as well. And it was just like the martial art that everybody talked about, and therefore it was popular, and therefore a lot of schools had judo. And back then it was in YMCAs, you know, it was in a lot of schools, and yeah, a lot of YMCAs had judo. The collegiate judo program was thriving, you know, so colleges had it. And, you know, the collegiate national championships used to be a very big tournament. Today it might have 150 competitors. It's a tiny thing, you know. So the sport's definitely gone down, but the level of the top athletes has not. Like the level of our best, we have the best today would have beaten the best years ago. Mm. You know, the Kayla Harrisons and the Travis Stevens, and those guys are still at a really high level. But, you know, it took a lot to get them there, and it was done with a small group of resources.
Yeah. So how did you feel when, you saw the Gracie family? You remember watching the early UFCs when they?
I watched them all. I watched every single one.
So how did you feel seeing? I mean, it was nice to see grappling, but just to kind of see the Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu sect kind of grow. How do you feel as a judoka?
Yeah, I think it's great. I give credit to the Gracies. I give credit to Jiu-Jitsu and what it's evolved and what it's become. You know, I do see it as an art that's very similar to judo, right? A lot of the submission holds, a lot of the arm locks and chokes are no different than what we do in judo. Obviously, when you get into the sport of it, right, and you're actually like trying to perfect judo or jiu-jitsu, and you get into the rules and you get into points and things like right. that, you know, it's hard for a judo guy to succeed in jiu-jitsu and vice versa, right, because of the rule set. But all of them, in terms of like self-defense or in terms of like, you know, it's very similar in terms of the chokes and the arm locks, submissions, right, takedowns, grappling. So I'm very proud that a grappling art proved itself in mixed martial arts. I mean, we all know that, you know, if you can take down, sorry, I hit my screen here. Give me one sec. Bad finger to the keyboard there. You know, we all know that if you can close the distance on a grappler, right? And you can take, I'm sorry, yeah, close the distance on a striker and take them down, then, you know, it's kind of like a shark in water, right? You're going to be able to finish the guy. And I think they proved that, and hats off to them. And I'm proud to be a grappling martial art, and I'm glad that they did what they did. And I'm super happy for the sport of jiu-jitsu, you know? Yeah. And what it's done is it's, you know, UFC or MMA and television really is a marketing tool for jiu-jitsu. Every single day, they validate jiu-jitsu. And if you hear Joe Rogan or any of the commentators, you're always talking about what rank this guy is in jiu-jitsu, who his instructor is, or what his lineage is in jiu-jitsu. And it basically just validates the sport, and it's the greatest marketing tool you guys could have ever asked for, you know? And fortunately for you now, Jiu-Jitsu Academies, you have a Jiu-Jitsu Academy almost in every city in America.
Right.
You know, someone drives 5 minutes or 10 minutes, they're at a Jiu-Jitsu school, which is great. And where judo falls short is that even people like Rhonda that did have a ton of success, or now Kayla, and before we had Rick Hahn, who made it to the Bellator finals 3 times as a judoka, or Carlo Parisian.
Right.
Regardless of what marketing, you know, MMA provided for judo, the challenge is there's not enough judo clubs in this country, you know, to support the demand, even if there was a demand, right? Because you're not going to drive an hour and a half to the nearest judo school just to try it out. So it's not accessible to people. And therefore, even if we did have a big marketing push, until we have professional schools that are local, nobody's going to join.
Yeah. And I've from MMA, I've been, you know, lucky to be exposed to just a lot of Olympic judo guys, high level judokas from like other countries, like in France and,
and
they're such good grapplers, you know. I mean, you know, some aren't, right? Some aren't,
right,
you know, and it's such a range depending on their style, right, of judo.
It really comes down to your instructor in the school that you came from, you know, right, because there are some schools of judo that really focus a lot on the groundwork and the ground aspect of the game, and,
well,
you know, maybe do 50-50 standing versus ground. So the people that come from good schools of judo that focus on the ground, they're very well versed in it. you know, could they win or submit a jiu-jitsu guy? Probably not, but at least they'd hold their own.
Yeah.
And when it came to takedowns, they would dominate there, and on the ground, maybe it's, you know, they know enough not to get submitted, you know, perhaps, but, you know, definitely good grapplers because it's such a physical sport. And, you know, the guys that are at the highest level, you know, they've been around the world, you know, and they've trained with the best people in all countries. And we go to training camps, it might be 1,000 players. There's 1,000 people at a judo camp in France.
Right.
You know, when you're at a training, and it's all top level guys. There's not a guy there that's like a brown belt or a purple belt. They're all black belts. They're all the best in their country. And it's just like it's a free for all. It's just like everybody just trying to be the alpha person in a room of 1,000 guys, and they just pound on each other. And it gets pretty vicious.
Yeah. Yeah, like the it's got to be, I just think of it like just compared to like other countries, because like in France, for example, it's just so main, it's a lot more mainstream. It's still, it's not like mainstream, right? It's not like a soccer or something, but to see it in these other countries be more popular, you know, and even like Brazil, you know, I lived in Brazil when I was younger, just to kind of see it more out there. It's got to be, how does it make you feel? To see here in the U.S. and where did we go wrong, or what could have been done better?
First of all, it's great to see that it's super successful in all those countries. I mean, the sport is in over 200 countries.
Yeah,
over 200 countries, and there are some, like you mentioned, France, Brazil, Japan, that it's part of the school systems.
Right.
So that's really why it's so successful, is because they have it's like Abu Dhabi today, right? They're putting it in. Every kid is exposed to judo in France. It's part of their physical education curriculum, you know, so therefore everybody knows the sport. They're aware of the sport anyway, or they've tried the sport at some point in time, which then leads to they understand how difficult the sport is, how challenging it is to learn, and then they respect the sport more. And then on top of that, when you look at countries like Brazil or France specifically, even Japan, when it comes to the Olympic Games, and you look at the number of medals that those countries win in the Olympic Games, it's not that many. Like France might win 20 medals in all sports. Brazil might win 5. Where are those medals coming from? A majority of the medals are coming from judo. So like in Brazil, 5 medals, maybe 3 comes from judo.
Right.
Well, those judo people are now the superheroes of their country, much like France and Japan now. So, you know, it gives validity to that sport, and it makes more people want to try that sport and do that sport because they see that it's a path to excellence and a path to, you know, even being a career for them in their country.
Right. Yeah.
To make a living from it or become famous and then become successful in other things. Whereas the United States, I was one athlete of 101 that won a medal in Atlanta. So, you know, there's 100 other medalists. It's hard to be a name. In fact, the day that I won my medal, I was scheduled to be on all these different TV shows the next day, you know, Good Morning America, the Today Show. They all called me. I was supposed to be on the shows. Well, that same night that I competed, the women's gymnastics team won the gold medal. And I got a call like 2 a.m. Hey, sorry, we don't need you on. You're a judo guy. We're going to have the gymnast on instead. It's a bigger story. So you just get bumped out, you know, and it's like one of those things. It's
frustrating for me watching the Olympics because that's all I want to watch, right? And, you know, you have, like, the ribbon. I don't even know what the name of that sport is. And just all these random sports, right?
Rhythmic gymnastics.
Rhythm gymnastics. It's all, you know, it's difficult. And, you know, I respect the dedication and all that. It's just, like, I want to see judo. I want to see wrestling. I want to see, you know, the fighting, the combat sports, you know? And, you know, it's frustrating for sure. And then, you know, I look at these other countries, like, you know, in Armenia or Russia, right? Man, if you make, like, I'm talking about wrestling too, right?
Yeah.
If you win a medal at the Olympics, like, you're taken care of for life. Mm-hmm. Like, you're set, you know? And then, you know, a lot of the wrestlers here, like, being around them, like, you know, it's like you're struggling, right? You're struggling. You need sponsors. People need to help you out. And nobody, like you said, you got bumped, you know, after getting a medal, you know, for, you know, the gymnastics team that won, you know? Yeah.
It's a business.
It's a business.
Business for the Olympic Committee. They, you know, they got to promote the stars. They got to, you know, what generates a lot of money. Gymnastics generates way more revenue than judo ever will for this country from TV rights and things like that. So you don't have a chance when you're up against one of the marquee sports, track and field or gymnastics or swimming. You know, you just can't compete.
I'm so biased for combat sports, especially like, you know, wrestling, judo, just of the human spirit, the example of the human spirit. And how can we change that? How can we change that? How can we make it more popular here in the U.S.?
It comes down to TV demand, right? If to be honest with you, judo now in the Olympic Games, it's featured far more than it ever was before. And that's because there is a following for it. And it's fortunate that a lot of Brazilian jiu-jitsu instructors came from Brazil, brought Brazilian jiu-jitsu here to America. They taught a ton of students. And now you've got, I don't know what the number of people doing jiu-jitsu today in this country is, right. But it's got to be well over a million, right?
Yeah.
So you got over a million people now who will watch judo. Like, they want to see grappling. So now we have an audience for it, especially at the time of the Olympic Games. And therefore, they feature judo more and they show it more on demand and things like that now, and they make it accessible, whereas they didn't in the past.
Yeah.
Because there wasn't an audience for it.
Yeah. Plus the UFC, right? The UFC.
All that helps. All that helps all the grappling sports, right? And it is a shame because, you know, the wrestlers, our American wrestlers, they're number one or number two in the world always. It's between them and Russia,
right,
who has the best team in the world, right? And, you know, to make it to the top in wrestling is not easy. That's a very competitive sport. It's in all the junior high schools. It's in the high school system. They got a big youth program. The NCAA is very difficult with like 95 Division I colleges. So to be an All-American in wrestling is hard. And even the All-Americans, a lot of them, they never make our world team. They never get to represent our country outside because afterwards there's a whole nother sport you got to learn. You got to learn freestyle, you know? And then I was just talking about the other day. I mean, there's 10 weight classes at the world championships in wrestling, but at the Olympic Games, there's only seven. So you've got, for us, we've got four world champions that are going to fill two slots. You know, you've got like Kyle Daigh, David Taylor, you've got Jaden Cox, and you've got Kyle Snyder. And out of those four guys, only two of them are going to make the Olympic team. That's a tough team to make, you know. And then at the end, those guys are grinding always. They don't make much money, you know. But at least for them, after the Olympics, if they want to be in the sport forever, they can go get a Division I coaching job. They can, you know, make over six figures coaching a marquee program and have a good life being a wrestling coach.
And now we have MMA too, right? Now there's MMA outlet as well.
The hard part with sports like judo and wrestling, especially the ones that pursue it and go to the Olympics, is that 100% focus goes into that training for 10, 12, 15 years in some cases. And by the time they even think about MMA, they're already in their early 30s. You know, and they've been broke their whole life or, you know, struggled their whole life. Now they're 30. It takes, you know, 6, 8 years to really get good at MMA because you can't just be a one-trick pony anymore. You know, you can't just have jiu-jitsu. You've got to be able to wrestle. You've got to be able to take people down. You've got to be able to strike. If you can't take them down, everybody's got good takedown defense now. So you better be able to, you know, fight five rounds standing. So if you're a judo player or wrestler, you got to know how to throw hands really good to be successful in MMA. You really have to be well-rounded today. And so it's not quite as easy as it was years ago, you know, to be successful in MMA. You've got to dedicate yourself 100%. And it's going to take you a good 6, 8 years to make it. And you're not going to do that when you're in your early 30s, you know?
Right. But you guys have, you know, you got wrestlers too, right? That you guys have the base, you know, hopefully. And everybody has different styles, right? So everybody has different styles that maybe that some translate, some don't, right?
It really comes down to those guys that can grind. If you've got some super tough grinders, I mean, the best thing for MMA is taking anybody who right out of college, who just, you know, was all American as a wrestler, say, okay, now you're only 21, 22 years old. We'll put you in a program for 6 years. We can give you a career in MMA, and they might never make it to the Olympics, but they're definitely going to be a top five guy probably in mixed martial arts if they, you know, if they really have that desire and are willing to learn.
Yeah.
And you see it. I mean, almost every champion today in MMA is from a wrestling pedigree. You know, Justin Gaethje's going against Conor McGregor. Their background is, you know, grappling. You got DC who just retired. You know, he's a two-time champ wrestler. You got Henry Cejudo, two belts wrestler, you know. The list goes on and on. Usman and Woodley and, you know, it's so, it all comes from that wrestling mentality, and they've been smart enough to learn enough jiu-jitsu that they don't get submitted, right?
Along the way, yeah.
So, that's the key.
Man, I was hanging out with I was around Joe Warren when he lost his wrestling, you know, sponsorships and stuff like that, and he got suspended, got in trouble, and he started fighting MMA, you know. And I mean, it was within like, I mean, was it 6 months? He's already like, you know, top of the food chain for Bellator,
right?
You know, right. That's crazy, you know. Say it totally gives you the base, right? Well, it depends on your style, you know. I know other guys that, you know, I haven't done so well, but you know, it's and then you talk about, you know, you spend all your whole time, you know, you're broke, you know. And Rhonda, I remember Rhonda when she came in here, and when I met her, she was like, you know, she didn't have money for gas. How old was she when she started fighting?
Started fighting MMA?
Yeah.
I would say she was 22, 23. Because
okay, yeah.
She won a medal in the Olympics at 20. She was 20 when she won her bronze, and then she took a year off. She was supposed to come back and go do judo again. That put her at 21, and that's when she started her MMA career. So 21, 22.
Yeah. I mean, it's crazy though, right? You're like a, you know, like a, I don't know. For me, right? If I look at it like a, you know, national, like a hero, you know, representing the U.S. And then you get nothing, right? All the wrestlers too, and the judokas.
It's hard, you know, it's a business, right? So the Olympics it's also a business. And the same happened to Kayla Harrison. You know, she's a two-time gold medalist in the Olympic Games. But the day that you say, I'm retiring, I'm not going to go 4 more years, then everything shuts off. You don't get a monthly stipend anymore from the Federation. You don't get a monthly stipend anymore from the Olympic Committee. All your sponsors go away because you're not going to compete in the sport anymore. They're not going to get any return. So your money goes from, you know, $100,000 or more down to zero right away as soon as you say you retire, you know? So now you got to make it in something else. And it's tough.
How do you feel seeing the judokas, especially like these, you know, Olympians and world champions fighting in MMA?
Great.
Do you watch every single fight?
I watch a lot of the UFC. I watch a lot of it when it's, you know, when I can catch it or when I'm. It's a lot harder to follow. Well, now during COVID, it's easy, right? Now it's easy to follow because there's only so many events and they're every couple weeks, and you know it's hard to stage the event. So I've been following every single one through COVID. I used to follow everyone when it came around every like 3 or 4 weeks before, but then. You know, when they did the deal with ESPN, it's on like ESPN Plus and it's on ESPN 2, and like every single weekend there's fights.
I can't even find it.
I just couldn't keep up, you know, and that's when I lost interest. I actually lost interest because it was on so much.
Yeah. You know? Did you see that? There was a video circulating of Henry Cejudo and Kayla discussing like who can be the greatest
combat athlete
of all time.
Yeah.
How amazing was that?
It was great. Yeah. Both great people, you know, both great people. I love Henry. I love Kayla, obviously. But it's funny, you know, it's an interesting conversation. He can go back and win the Olympics twice. Very hard to win the Olympics twice in any sport.
Yeah.
Any sport, you know, but let alone wrestling or judo, you know. I mean, if you're the fastest guy in the world, you're the fastest guy in the world, and nobody can beat your time. I just can't beat your time, right? I mean, it's hard to keep it up for Olympic after Olympic, but you know going in how fast you can run. In combat sports, you never know who you're going to fight. You don't know, you know, it changes. Even during the day, you don't know. Some guy knocks off somebody else. You weren't expecting to fight him. You don't know as much about this guy. And, you know, the surprises that happen. I mean, when Henry won the Olympics, he was ranked like 25 in the world. He wasn't even expected to medal. You know, he ended up winning the Olympics. So, you know, it's definitely hard to repeat.
Yeah. I thought that was an awesome conversation. You know, I want to ask you about Kayla. Like, what made her special? What do you think was this, her secrets? But, you know, what made her success in winning?
You know,
and twice.
All of the, what's that?
And even twice, right? Two gold medals.
I mean, it's a combination of a lot of things, right? It's not one single thing that helped her. It's a combination of the environment that she was in, the people that had to help her along the way. My dad played a huge role in helping her get over her sexual abuse. You know, he had talks with her all the time about, you know, the way she felt and the way she was thinking and how she's supposed to think and how she's supposed to feel. And, you know, that took him years to sort of break that down and help her build back from that. But it's also the coaching with the technical training, spending the time with her on the road at training camps, showing her what she's doing wrong. But, you know, credit to Kayla, one of the best things that she has is, you know, because she had to overcome such adversity, she's mentally tough. You know, she mentally wants to prove that, you know, that didn't define her and that you can overcome, you know, hardship and be great. And she was rebuilt as a machine, you know, and she's a mental machine as well. She doesn't have any quit in her. She'll train. You tell her to train 5 times a day. She'll train 5 times a day. She'll do what she's told. She'll put her head through a wall. You know, she's mentally tough. She can't be broke. So that, you know, you have that trait of as an athlete that's A, willing to work, and B, willing to listen, doesn't let their ego get in the way, and understands that, you know, to be great, I've got to continue to develop. I've got to continue to learn. I'm never too good to train, you know, and do what I'm told. So it's a combination of a lot of things that makes her great. But obviously, I think her mental fortitude definitely is probably the prevailing factor.
Yeah, mental toughness. I mean, not too many people with weak mental going to the Olympics, right? From any country.
Yeah, but you'd be surprised. I mean, a lot of people might not, you know, they make it to the Olympics, but they don't necessarily think they're the best. They don't believe they're the best. You know, and if you don't believe you're the best, then you don't believe you can win the gold. You can't go in there thinking, well, maybe I hope I can win a bronze medal, or I hope I can win a couple matches. You got to go in there thinking you can win it all. You know, and you've got to fight and compete like you're going to win it all, or it's never going to happen. You know, and that's one thing I think Kayla really embraced the mental training that we do at the school, you know, and because she came when she was so young and impressionable, she was 15 years old when she came to us. I used to give talks every month on different attributes, whether it was goal setting, whether it was discipline, perseverance, whether telling stories of times where I felt down or felt like I wasn't going to make it. But the way you have to think of it as a champion, the way you have to visualize success, you have to give yourself some positive self-talk. You know, you've got to use all these tools. And I think because she was so impressionable when she was listening to all those stories, she absorbed it all. It all sunk in. It became part of her DNA. And she learned how to, you know, how to convince herself to succeed mentally and physically and put it all together and became just an unbelievable, like, champion for our country. You know, she was one of the most dominant judo players that the world has ever seen, because, you know, not only did she win 2 Olympic Games, but she won every major judo event on the circuit. And I'm talking gold, you know, gold in Tokyo, gold in Paris, or gold in Germany, and gold at the World Championships. When you look at other athletes, you know, like even like a Travis Stevens or a Ronda Rousey, they weren't gold medalists at all of the major events. They placed, they might have podiumed at some of them, but they weren't dominant like Kayla was. Kayla beat everybody in the world over and over and over again all the time, you know, and very rarely did she get beat.
Hero, man, national hero. It's crazy, you know. I was following her after the first gold medal, you know, and then I was just nonstop, and then she went for it again.
And she was well-rounded, right? She was exceptional on her feet with great posture and great throwing ability. She obviously had, you know, understood the gripping game and understood how to take her opponent's, you know, strengths away from them by gripping and understanding how to put her hands on the gi properly. But she also had great transitions and groundwork. You know, she won all the matches that she won in Rio when she repeated. She won all of her matches on the ground, either choke or armbar or pin. So, you know, she was just a well-rounded athlete.
Your dad, your you know, your dad's school, your school. You know, and I never went there, but just the people you guys are producing, the athletes you guys are producing, like, you guys are, I assume you're a well-rounded school. You would cover, you know, you kind of do, you're a complete school. you know, takedowns to Niwaza to the ground, right?
Absolutely. We spent a lot. I mean, you know, I have a wrestling background. I wrestled in high school. I wrestled in college. I wrestled Division I alongside my judo career. You know, a lot of times I'd take off from wrestling to go to judo and be away on a trip for a week. And I'd come back and I'd start for my team and I'd wrestle, you know, in all the meets as well. And I kind of did both, but we used a lot of grappling and wrestling in our groundwork game as well. You know, so it made our guys very tough. And we also cross-trained and learned from the Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu guys and incorporated that into our judo takedown and transition game as well. So, like I said, you always have to learn.
Yeah, I've learned so much from judo, but it's just different things, different controls, different, you know. And like I said, it depends on the school that you go to, right? But I've learned so many, like, different, you know, just different controls and different movements, you know, from judo.
One of the things that does kill judo in America is that, you know, we have a lot of older out of shape instructors that, you know, they don't continue to train or don't continue to stay fit. And so what ends up happening is they become complacent, they become somewhat lazy, and they no longer train in the sport. They don't, even if you're not doing randori, you still should be doing uchikomi, you still should be doing movement stuff. So your skills stay sharp. But a lot of our instructors, they kind of get out of shape or they stop training themselves, let themselves go. And then when they have a student that comes in, and maybe it's a Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu guy who's, I got to learn judo takedowns, they go to the school and they, you know, they look at the instructor or they look at the instructor's students who may not train that hard or they don't respect the sensei, you know, because he's not representative of what they're looking for. Or they also don't give them what they want. They make them go learn ukemi and how to fall for 6 months before they let them in the class. They're old school. So they don't give the student what they're looking for, which is, hey, I want to learn takedowns for my jiu-jitsu. And right. You've got to have a program that can help that guy. You can't have a one-size-fits-all program. And a lot of our judo clubs are just one-size-fits-all. They have one class for kids, one class for adults. It could be your first day of training or it could be your sixth year in the sport, you're in the same class, you know. And that's one thing we do at our academy is we segment everybody. If you're in the competition group, you're here. If you're a white belt, you're over here. You've got a separate class. If you've been here 6 months, then you're in this class. And it's broken down by age and skill level, much like as Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu school.
Yeah.
Now, and it makes people feel comfortable. And then you also become specialists. So your elite guys can be more elite and your beginners can enjoy themselves.
Yeah. I'd love to visit your school one day, if that would be possible.
Welcome anytime. I've had everybody and anybody come visit, so you're welcome anytime.
Where's your school located at?
It's in Wakefield, Massachusetts.
How far is that
from? About 20 minutes north of Boston.
Boston, okay, yeah, nice. I think it was alternate for the Olympics. He's from El Salvador. You know, his mentors were Cuban. I think for Sydney Olympics. His name is Ronald Cruz, and so he teaches a judo class here. One for the adults, one for the kids, just because, you know, jiu-jitsu guys are, let's say they're lazy, but they want to work on their stand-up, right? Because, you know, they're scared of falling or whatever it is, you know. But, you know, one of the things I noticed, right, is it's different having somebody that really knows how to fall, do a break fall, compared to having a jiu-jitsu guy do a, you know, an average jiu-jitsu guy. Your break fall, you know,
for sure.
What you see actually happening, and the kids too, I see it in their eyes and their faces.
So you asked me about the one of the best, like the best way for judo to grow in this country, or the fastest way it can grow in this country, in my opinion, is for, and I'm working on a program now, so so coming soon is having a judo curriculum, takedowns only. Yeah. Specifically for Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu instructors.
Yeah.
If you want to become certified in judo and how to teach judo to your students, here's a program. You take it back, and then we can, judo people, give you the tools. You can now have all of your students that are interested in judo. Maybe you got a school of 200 Jiu-Jitsu guys. Maybe 50 of them want to do takedowns and learn judo in a real way. You're now certified to do it, and that introduces judo to your Jiu-Jitsu people. and maybe they'll end up starting, you know, to compete in tournaments in judo perhaps, or they find an interest in loving the sport. But at least it opens up and gets more people doing judo in this country right away. And you can do that in every state, and you can do that in, you know, five schools in every state. Now we got 250 judo academies overnight. You know, and it also separates your school from the guy down the street who doesn't offer that. And it makes your students better.
Let me know when that's out, because I'm in.
We're working on it.
I'll be your first customer.
Awesome.
Get in line. You know, just I believe in people being well-rounded, you know, not only in the grappling, but also even for self-defense, for fight. They should know how to fight as well, you know.
Sure.
We do Muay Thai. We do, you know, jiu-jitsu, of course. And I have, you know, some wrestling and judo as well. And I've been doing strength. What's that?
I would say the other part that's important is that, you know, jiu-jitsu is about lineage, right? It's all about who your master instructor was or who you learned your skills from. And we can, Travis Stevens and myself, put together a nice program for jiu-jitsu guys. Now it can come from the top, and now you're learning the real thing from real athletes, and, you know, it's credible, and we know it works, and you're going to only learn the good stuff, right? So then you're passing down the best knowledge possible to your students, and you understand the value of that lineage, and then you're going to ideally end up becoming a certified black belt in judo as well.
Yeah. There's no reason why everybody shouldn't, I think. If you dedicated that many years to jiu-jitsu, how can you not know how to take somebody down, right?
Right.
And some black belts that don't know how to do takedowns, right? A lot, you see that, you know, so that didn't happen. So I was going to ask.
Quite honestly, I think that, you know, for young kids, especially when you're talking about, you know, 6, 7, 8 years old, it is really hard to teach them jiu-jitsu. I mean, you can teach them break falls, but realistically, for them, judo is a really fun sport because it's so interactive, and it's a lot easier for them to learn the throws and takedowns at that age. It's probably the best base.
That's it.
Then they go into jiu-jitsu. You know, it's all under the guise of jiu-jitsu, but that throwing ability and takedowns and things like that, that's probably the best way to keep those young kids interested. It's a heck of a lot easier to teach, too.
Yeah. Yeah, that's good. That's good. I was going to ask you, I was finished. I was going to ask you a question after my long rant about, jiu-jitsu and judo, but I was going to ask you why somebody should train judo in jiu-jitsu, you know, because I guess I was saying, like, we're worried about, you know, getting hurt, falling, you know, because stand up and things like that, you know, why should somebody train judo with their jiu-jitsu?
Well, first of all, I think every sport does start standing, you know what I mean? And I think the judo defense, you know, it would be very difficult for a jiu-jitsu guy who didn't train takedowns to ever take down a judo guy. It would just be, I want to say it's impossible, but it would be very difficult for them to do it if they didn't want to be taken down, you know, if they wanted to remain standing. And that every fight starts standing. So I understand you can dive at people's legs and you can, you know, spin on your back and, you know, get in a guard position, but it's not reality in a street fight. And we know that you have to be able to close the distance and at least grab the guy and wrap him up and get him to the ground so that you can submit him, right? So you've got to do, whether it's jiu-jitsu stand-up training or jiu-jitsu training, you have to learn that aspect of the game for self-defense, right? And if you want to beat other jiu-jitsu guys, you can't just train jiu-jitsu. You know, I think you've got to have a point of differentiation. You've got to be able to do something differently. And if it's just for the sport of it, then win the takedown, because if you win the takedown, you can probably win the match, you know, as long as you're defensively good enough not to give up your back or get swept, right? I mean, the takedown is 2 points and you're ahead. So, you know, you can learn it for that aspect as well. But also I think it makes you more well-rounded and it makes you tougher. You know, saying that you get hurt getting taken down, well, you know, I think it makes your body tough, judo. You know, and I don't think that novice people should do throws. You know, I think you can get a great judo workout in and learn all the skills of judo without ever having to fall. You know, and you can get, and the key to having a successful judo school in terms of having a big academy, and I have 220 students at my judo academy on a normal basis, not now with COVID, but normally I have 220 judo students. That doesn't include my toddler program that has 50 in it. That's just straight judo students. So, and the key is giving them a great workout, teaching them all of the good movements, posture movements, foot techniques, how to pick somebody up, how to, you know, come in a proper technique, and just doing lots of drills with them, you know, and having them the repetition, uchikomi, fitting in on the throw, picking up your partner, fitting in on the throw, movement drills into the throws and things like that. Like, they get a great workout. They're physically exhausted. They're learning good judo. They're not being thrown. They're not getting hurt. And after they do that for a period of, like, you know, 1 to 2 years, now their bodies are stronger, tougher, more aware of what's going on. Then you can introduce the throwing aspect and potentially the randori for the ones that want it. But you don't need to take novice people and throw them on the ground. It doesn't make sense. The last time that person probably did a somersault, you know, in their life was probably in grade school, which was 20 years ago.
Right.
You know, that's a scary thing to leave your feet and land on your back.
Right. Right.
You know, yeah. You know, if they don't want it, why make them do it? They don't need it to learn good judo. The goal of judo is not to get thrown.
Right. Right. Yeah. So how do you stay healthy? How do you stay, you know, mobile? How do you stay healthy, injury free, after all these years?
It's funny, as you and I are sitting here talking, I got a back spasm going on. Like, my neck has been killing me for weeks. Like, I can't, like, right now I can't train. I've got a stim unit right here. It goes on. I put this on every day to try to work out the muscles I had a bad neck injury in my career, and I think now I've got arthritis in that area, in that neck, and a lot of times my muscles spasm up and, like, contract and it just acts up on me every 6 months or so, and I gotta go through, like, stim units and massage therapy and things like that to try to work it out. But on a normal basis, I try to work out every single day. So, you know, I have a gym in my basement of my house. So through this whole COVID thing, I've been training, like, sometimes twice a day. But I've got a treadmill, I've got an elliptical, I've got a rowing machine, I've got a bike, you know, an Aerodyne, I've got an Olympic weight set, all the dumbbells I need, all the bands and medicine balls and stuff. So I work out every day, functional strength training stuff, lifting. I also, you know, go to my academy and I still drill. I still work out with the teenagers. I work out with the, you know, the young, what, lighter weight guys that are black belts and stuff, just to keep moving and doing stuff. Yeah. I can't, you know, I have to be careful working out with the Olympic level guys. I tried that, you know, 4, 5, 6 years ago, and I get injured every time because I'm so competitive. I want to go 100%, you know, and my body can't go 100% anymore. It's too explosive. There's too much torque on the body, and it's too physically demanding. So after I like tore my hamstring, it put me out 6 months. I was like 42 years old then. Once that thing took me out, my body just kind of, like, said, you can't do judo full force anymore. You know, and that just killed me. So now I just work out with the teenage kids, work out with the lighter weight guys, just to keep the movement and stay fit, and it's not so physically hard on my body.
Stay moving.
That's what I do.
How about your father? What you know, he studied with Russians and, you know all over the world. Did he stay healthy his whole life?
No, you know, he had disc problems in his back. He had, you know, some back surgeries. But, you know, other than that, he stayed pretty much injury free. If you see my dad today, he's, you know, he's fit. He's 74 years old. He's got biceps on him. He's a fit guy. He's got abs. Like, he works out twice a day, every day himself. Right now he's doing more like a lot of, like, circuit training stuff where he just goes from one exercise to another without rest. High repetition, low weight, just to stay fit. But, man, he's, you know, he's still got some really good muscle tone to him, and he's still a fit guy.
Have you ever?
It's got to be a way of life. Like, working out's got to be a way of life. You can't stop.
You can't stop.
You're finished.
Have you ever heard of a person named Scott Sonnen? He does, like, a tack fit, circular strength training. He uses, like, club bells and. There's, like, a lot of, like, joint movements, you know? So I've gone, like, all in the last few years, and it's really helped me just add all these injuries, and it's really helped me recover from those things. I'm just curious, because I do a lot of those mobility drills, you know, it's really transformed me. And a lot of my jiu-jitsu friends, I show them things like little flows, like little yoga flows to you know, keep moving, like you go slow, right, to kind of recalibrate everything and to connect,
So I was before COVID, you know, before COVID, I was doing hot yoga, you know, I was doing that to stay limber. I think the key to staying injury free is flexibility. When I was younger, I was super flexible. I could almost do a full split. I could put my whole chest and my head on the ground in between my legs. You know, I could lay backwards with my, I was super limber and flexible. So I hardly ever got injured as an athlete. Mm. Now, you know, I'm not as flexible. And so I'm trying, I was doing really good before COVID. I went to yoga at least once a week. I would go to like a massage therapist once every couple of weeks just to get that going. And then I would work out on top of it. So I had a good flow going, but now it's, can't do any of that. I'm just lifting by myself downstairs in my basement, you know?
Opposite of health, all these protocols, all these health protocols. It's crazy.
Right. Exactly.
You know, one thing I wanted to bring up, you know, I remember going to like Abu Dhabi and talking to a lot of old school, like Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu black belts, you know, and like the Sheikh, right, of Abu Dhabi is trying to get it into the Olympics, right? Getting Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu or Jiu-Jitsu into the Olympics. And a lot of these old school guys, they don't want it to go to the Olympics because they feel like it's going to, you know, take away from, you know, whatever.
Take away from money. That's all it's going to take away, because as a sport, you know, when a sport becomes an Olympic sport, it now has, you know, first of all, it creates an international demand for the sport. So now people that might not do jiu-jitsu in other countries will start doing jiu-jitsu because it's a chance for them to get to the Olympics.
Right.
So it actually will grow the sport naturally because it's an Olympic sport. That's number one. Number two, you know, I'll say unvalidate is the right word, but, you know, obviously right now the IBJJF probably is the most recognized titles in jiu-jitsu, right? It's IBJJF world champion. Right. Obviously UAEJJ is elevating its game, and it's an international thing. And, you know, they're doing a great job promoting the sport and organizing it with world circuit events and things like that. But it's a threat to the IBJJF, right? Because the Olympics is going to come up with a set of rules that's going to be decided. This is the rules that we play by, and everybody's then going to either have to follow suit, or people may not go to your events because they're trying to go the Olympic circuit. And, you know, the Olympic Games is going to, obviously being the title holder of that, it's going to be way more important than being IBJJF champion, right? So it's going to make their events smaller and less significant, and perhaps take away from their participation, you know?
Yeah. I mean, I love, I see both sides, you know, and they, you know, they want it to take away from the self-defense, like the aspect, you know, when I look at judo, when I think about judo, actually, just like Jigoro Kano, like he wanted to make it an Olympic sport, like 100 years ago, it was like similar to Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, a lot more similar, a lot more groundwork and things like that. And then it turned to like Olympic sport, and a lot of, like, you, depending on the school, some schools just focus on the throwing, right? To make it more spectator friendly. And so I think that's the perspective, right, where that they're coming from, is they don't want to have it take away the essence of it, you know?
Well, right, because once you put a set of rules together of how you win the game, everybody changes and adapts to those rules. Because at the end of the day, the goal is to win, you know, win the match, win the game.
Right.
And what's happened to judo over the years, there's been so many different rule changes. It actually changes who becomes the best in the world because of that rule set. And there was a time, you know, I think it was 2008, I think it was the 2008 Olympics or 2012, where Japan didn't win gold on the men's side, or they won one gold. They had hardly any medals on the men's side of it. And that was when you could do leg grabs, you could do unorthodox grips. There was like, the game was very different than it is today. Right. Today, the whole game is set up for pure judo. No leg grabs, no unorthodox grips. You know, you cannot win by decision, you have to win by a score. And the scores now, there's no more small scores, you've got to put the guy on his back to get a score. So the whole sport is now skewed to stand up traditional judo. Well, who's going to win in that game? The traditionalists, which is Japan, right? They have the bodies. That's how they train. So if you can't be unorthodox to win, then, you know, you've got to beat them at their own game. You know, it would be kind of like saying in baseball, you know, you can't throw a curveball, you can't throw a changeup, you've got to just throw smoke right down the middle. You know, think about all you can do is throw a fastball. So whoever's throwing 100 mile an hour fastballs, they're going to win over the guy that throws a 90 mile an hour fastball, because they can see the 90 mile an hour ones all day long. They can't see the 100 mile fastball. You know what I mean? Like, it's just suited for them so much now that it's,
Are they the ones who changed the rules?
Well, no. I mean, there's an entire international, committee board, made up of committee. Coaches around the world.
It's unbelievable that people spend their whole life doing fireman's carries and lifts. A lot of my Armenian friends, that was their game, and now all of a sudden it's like pretty much like a different sport for them.
And it's non-existent, right? And they changed it so abruptly. It was like right after the 2012 Olympics, this changed. But the next year, everybody's got to change their whole game and reprogram their brains and all their techniques not to grab legs. And and they gave an automatic disqualification for the first infraction, is the way it used to be. It was insane. Matches were going like 10 seconds, and then we'd go all the way to Abu Dhabi to fight or Russia to fight. 10 seconds, you'd accidentally grab the leg. You'd go home. Single elimination. It was terrible.
Like the Brazilian girl, right, that ended up winning gold later. That she got disqualified, right? Was that the case? She
touched Rafaela Silva.
Yeah.
Rafaela Silva, yeah.
So she got disqualified because she touched the leg.
Right.
Oh man.
That's terrible. Right now everybody's used to the new rules. Everybody understands the new rules. They've adapted. The athletes have grown up and fought that way for a long time. So, it's second nature now to them.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much for making the time, and
my pleasure.
You're a legend, and not only as a competitor but as a teacher. I mean, I'm looking forward for this COVID mess to be over, so I can travel a little bit, and I'd love to visit your school if
you're welcome anytime.
Open,
and my pleasure to have you.
See what you guys are doing. I'm looking forward to the curriculum and all the stuff that you're doing to improve. I'd love to see judo more in jiu-jitsu schools, since that's my life. Because you start standing.
Watch out for it's called the American Judo System. So watch out. It's coming, nice. Coming soon. The American Judo System.
Nice. How can people find out about your school? Just information.
My school is pedrosjudo.com. You can hit me up there, and my program director will get you right in touch with me. Any questions you have, seminars or just questions about judo, I'm happy to help you out. Don't forget to check out fujimats.com. That's my company. I'm the owner and president of fujimats.com. And obviously, gi and gear stuff you need, hit us up at Fuji Sports. We'd love to help you or your academy with custom gi and gear.
Awesome. Thank you. Thank you,
Alberto. Thank you so much, brother. I appreciate you. You'll be good.
You too.
Take care.
Bye-bye. Cheers.